Another Brooklyn is the story of four girls growing up in Brooklyn, New York in the 1970s, 1980s. And it's a story of coming of age as a woman. It's a story of friendship. It's a story of coming to terms with death and dying. And it's a story of what it means to know what you want and to go get it. But beyond that, it's also a story about a neighborhood. It's a biography of the neighborhood of Bushwick, which between 1970 and 1990 changed drastically. And what I wanted to do with the book is really put it on the page and get people to see that when we think about gentrifying, when we think about neighborhoods changing, and when we think about discovering neighborhoods, that there were people who lived there, and those people were thriving, and those people were trying to find a way. So it's not like we come into a neighborhood and it doesn't have a history. And it's about the history of Bushwick, which in the book is a true story. So it's a nonfiction book in that the story of Bushwick is true. It's a novel in the fact that these four girls that I put on the page, I've made up. And it's poetry in that I'm very intentional about how I tell the story. From the first line, which is, for a long time, my mother wasn't dead yet. I start weaving what I hope is a very poetic narrative about people coming of age. The main character in Another Brooklyn is August. August is in her 30s when she comes back to the old neighborhood because her father has passed away. And that's where the book opens, with the burying of her father. And it goes, and she goes back, and coming back to the neighborhood, she runs into one of her closest friends from childhood who she's no longer friends with. And it kind of triggers all these memories of what her childhood was like. And so then she goes back into the story and tells us of her relationship with four girls, Sylvia, Angela, and Gigi. And then, of course, August, which spells out saga, which the book is, a saga of four girls. Angela wants to be a dancer. Gigi wants to be an actor. And Sylvia really wants to sing, but is a family that has moved to New York City from Martinique. And so as her father, who believes in French philosophers and the higher education, wants her to be a lawyer. And August, who's coming back, is a very well-known anthropologist. And so it's a story of how, as teenagers, their dreams were one thing, and then as adults, the dreams became another thing. Their lives as young girls in Brooklyn, in a neighborhood where young girls were constantly being watched as they grew up. And I think that's what makes it the universal story, is that it wasn't just happening in Brooklyn, in Bushwick, it's happening to girls all over the world. You know, you grow up and your growing can't be hidden from the world. And so you know, even from a young age, that you're being watched. And these girls form a kind of shield around each other and protect each other and love each other and grow up together. And then something happens to that friendship. I grew up in Bushwick, and when I was growing up, it was a neighborhood that was predominantly Black and Latino. The Black people had come through what was known as the Great Migration. And the Great Migration was a period in the United States from the early 1900s to the mid to late 1970s, where millions of African Americans left the really hard conditions of the South for places like New York, Chicago, California, Philadelphia. That was called the Great Migration. And so that migration, where people were trying to escape Jim Crow, where they were trying to escape lynching, where they were trying to escape Blacks being treated really brutally in the South, dropped a whole bunch of people in Brooklyn, including my family. And so Bushwick in the 1970s was that. It was people from the Great Migration, and it was immigrant families. So Latino families coming from Puerto Rico, coming from the Dominican Republic, Ecuador. And those two groups became this neighborhood. And it was a working class neighborhood, and it was a working class poor neighborhood. And it was people who were trying to, as we say in the United States, make a way out of no way, trying to build their lives up. And the kids of those people went on to college, and they went on, and a lot of them were first generation college goers. But it was a neighborhood of what we call strivers. And then in the 90s, crack hit. hit the neighborhood, and crack was the devastating drug that caused a lot of people to die, caused a lot of people to get rich, caused a lot of people to go to jail, and it devastated the neighborhood. And then toward the mid-90s, hipsters started moving to the neighborhood and discovering it was a cool place. You can create art there. You can get a really cheap rent. And so then, in the early 2000s, my mom died and left me the house in Bushwick. So I was going back and forth to deal with renovating the house and then eventually getting people into it. And by the time that happened, the street that had been predominantly Black and Latino was probably about half white. And those were kids who had trust funds. I don't know if they say that here. Kids coming from wealthy families and living in the hood because it was the cool place to live. And now it's changed in that it's one of the neighborhoods where lots of white families live. But when I was a kid growing up there, as the Black people and Latino people moved in, white people were leaving because it was called white flight, where white people moved to the suburbs and they moved upstate to get away from Black people and Latino people. So I call the kids who are moving back the great grandkids of the white flight people because their grandparents, their great grandparents were probably the ones who moved away from Bushwick, and now it's the cool place to come back to. So you see it in shows like Girlfriends is always, not Girlfriends, what Girls. There's a big show in America called Girls, and Bushwick is always featured on that show. A lot of movies feature Bushwick, whereas there was a time where people wouldn't even come into the neighborhood, white people wouldn't even come to the neighborhood. And for Black folks and Latino folks, it was a very safe haven because everybody knew everybody.